Okay, so we'll continue where we left off, and
yes,
but five past. So we'll continue where we left off before lunch, and let me just write down, just remind you what I did before lunch, and then we'll continue from there. So I defined these operators that were defined as. I defined this algebra, and then I defined these operators. And the equations that I used to define these operators were this. And there was another equation. And I argued for you that these equations all have solutions. There was a definition of the A tildes in this. But so far, I haven't told you, you know, why this is a good definition to use for these A tildes. So now what I want to do, and it's very easy to do, is I want to show you that these operators defined this way have just the right properties to play the roles of the mirror operators or the tilde operators that we discussed in the first few lectures. So let's start by checking various properties. For example, one thing we might want to check is a commutator. Okay. So one of the properties we demanded from the A tildes, or in this case the O tildes, because they're just proportional to the A tildes, right, this is an A and this is an O. Sorry, my handwriting is so bad. Okay. One of the properties we demanded from these guys was that they should commute with the ordinary operators, and this was something that was essential for locality to hold. So we can easily check that this is true. And let's say you take O tilde, you take an ordinary operator, and you act on. So the idea here is that you have some infalling observer. You know, there's some state. He falls into the state. He does some experiments. And then in one case, he measures O first and then O tilde. And then there's another experiment in which the same infalling observer goes in, falls, you know, does some experiments, then measures O tilde, and then measures O. And the question is whether you get the same results in those cases or not. Okay. Now, it's easy to use these equations to understand what's happening here. So there's one term here, which is omega omega A alpha psi. Okay. And there's another term here, which is omega omega A alpha psi. Okay. Now, this term, it's kind of written on the board. The second term is this one, okay? So we already know what this is. But the key point is, remember that this E was an algebra that was formed out of polynomials of these O's, okay? Therefore, this term here, which is O into A, is also an element of the algebra, okay? This guy is just another A, okay? It's some A alpha prime. It's some other element of the algebra. Okay. Now, this is not strictly true. It's not true because if this A was big enough, you know, if you did a huge point experiment, then there are these edge effects in the algebra. So we truncated the algebra. So it's not quite true. And these edge effects will be important. I'll come back to them. But you know, if you're doing a reasonable low point experiment, you can take your algebra to be big enough that you do an experiment and you add one more insertion, and that's still within the algebra. And so for any reasonable experiment, this O into alpha is still part of your algebra. And so this term is also, you know, the same. So omega A alpha, should put an omega prime, 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 A alpha into omega dagger, sorry, into e to the minus beta omega by 2. Well, I just use this equation, okay? And so this is clearly 0, because you get the same term from here and from here, okay? So clearly, the way it's defined, now you just use the definition and you recognize that when you're acting with some ordinary operators, say this, okay, this is the second line here. When you're acting with some ordinary operators, you just generate more elements of the algebra. And so it's clear that you work out this commutator, and the commutator is 0. Okay, so that's one of the properties that was important for us for locality. And remember, it was one of the arguments we gave. We said, you know, one of the arguments I mentioned earlier today, saying that if you try and define these O tildes, it's hard to get the commutator to vanish. But here you see that this is designed, these equations are designed, in order to make this commutator vanish. So within low point experiments, if you do ordinary experiments about some black hole, you explicitly find that the tildes commute with the O's, and they're designed to commute with the O's. Okay, let me now talk about another commutator, the canonical commutator. So this was a cross commutator. There was something else we wanted the tildes to obey, which is the canonical commutator. Okay. So we can check if that works out. Okay. So now we have omega tilde and omega tilde dagger. Okay. Maybe I should work with the A's. Well, okay. Doesn't matter. Into A alpha, into psi. Okay. So now you expand this out, and you find that there are two terms here. One term here, which is omega tilde, another term here, which is omega tilde dagger. Okay. Okay. So now we just have to use these rules. It's very simple. You look at omega tilde acting on A alpha. Okay. So and in this case, you have omega tilde dagger acting on A alpha. So let me put a prime. So this is omega, the two states, omega tilde, okay, acting on A alpha with omega prime. Remember, when the omega tilde dagger acts on an ordinary state, by this rule, it becomes an ordinary omega. So this becomes omega prime into psi into e to the plus beta omega prime by 2. Okay. So I use this one to take this guy and commute it through the A. Now you have this one, okay. So in this one you have omega prime dagger, and I use this rule, the first rule on the board here. Okay. So this becomes A alpha into omega dagger into psi. Okay. So I just use these rules. I've reached this step. Now I'm going to use the rules again. Let me go to this part of the board. Once again, you recognize that E alpha into omega is still part of the algebra, okay, unless you're on the edge of the algebra. So you use the rule once again. Oh, there's e to the minus beta omega by 2, which I shouldn't forget. Okay, so you use the rule again, and you find that this becomes E alpha omega prime, okay, into omega dagger psi. Okay, and this guy becomes E alpha into omega dagger, omega prime, into psi. Okay, and that came from here. It came from the fact that this turns into an ordinary omega. Okay, and this omega dagger. So this commutes through now both of these and goes and becomes an omega. I hope you can see how this follows. If you don't follow it on the board, I'm sure you'll be able to work it out using these rules. It's very simple. And then there are these factors. The factors that sit in the outside, in both cases, become common, and you get e to the minus omega by 2. Okay, but now you look at this term. This term is just the commutator of an omega prime with an omega dagger. Okay, so this is the ordinary commutator, and we know what this is. Okay, this is just this term g omega that we talked about. Okay, so you see that this just becomes, and it's in particular, it's proportional to delta omega prime omega, and as a result, this vanishes because this commutator is non-zero only when omega prime is equal to omega. So this becomes just A alpha, okay, into O omega prime into O omega prime dagger and psi. Okay, and there's a delta omega omega prime. And this is precisely the G omega that we had. Okay, so if you divide through by this by the G omega that I defined, which was the commutator, this will become an A tilde and A tilde dagger, and you find that that's just the same as the commutator of the A's and the A daggers. Okay, so the commutator of the A tilde and the A tilde dagger is the same as the commutator of the A's and the A daggers. And this is true, as you can see, on the state that you define these guys in, and on all descendants of the state produced by acting on it with reasonable single trace operators or products thereof. Okay, so you can see that this works out. And so the canonical commutators are also what we demanded that they should be. Okay, the other thing that was important to us were the correlation functions. Okay. So remember, we said that the correlation functions had to be of a particular kind, the two-point correlation functions. So let's check if that works. Okay. So let's see. So let's first check if the. So maybe I should use the A's. So maybe I should use the A's if it's. So the A's and the O's, I hope by now you're used to. There's just a factor of root G that goes in there. But the correlation function is better defined for the A's, so I'll just use the A's. I don't have to worry about factors of G then. Okay. So let's try and compute this correlation function, okay, this two-point correlation function. Now you see, when you compute this two-point correlation function, this is just A omega dagger, okay, A omega on psi. So what this means is you compute this. But the A tilde omega, in this case, A is just 1. Okay, so this is a special case of this rule with this capital A just set equal to 1, which is, of course, in a member of the algebra. Okay, so this is just psi A tilde dagger omega into A omega dagger psi into E to the minus beta omega by 2. Okay, now you use this rule again, this time with this guy. And you find that this is just psi A omega dagger into A omega psi. Okay? And the factor of e to the minus beta omega by 2 cancels. But this guy, we proved, I think in the first or the second lecture, has the right thermal properties. Okay? So this you can argue just on general grounds, independent of any definition of the tilde, that it has the right thermal properties. And what these rules are making sure is that the two-point correlation function of the tildes is the same as the two-point correlation function of the ordinary operators. So in particular, we know what this is. This is e to the minus beta omega by 1 minus e to the minus beta omega. Okay? And that's precisely what we wanted for this two-point correlation function. So that also works out. Okay? So this is for the correlator. This is for the correlator. Should change the heading. Okay. Correlator. Okay. Now I'm interested in the cross correlator. Okay. So one important thing I did in the first lecture was I said, remember, and that's been important, the tildes have to be correlated with the non-tilde guys, with the ordinary guys. Okay. So in particular, how does that happen? So to do that, what you need to do is look at a correlation function of a tilde and an ordinary guy, but both of them have to be annihilation operators in order to get a non-zero result. So it's a similar correlation function, but both of these have to be annihilation operators, and there's a similar answer in the case when both of them are creation operators. Okay? So now you use this rule. I'll just go through this on the board. I'll just erase some terms and make sure it works. So here I'm just defining the correlator. This is what it means. I just need to use the rule once, just in the first case. Okay. So this becomes now, A omega into an A omega dagger, right? Because the A tilde omega goes and hits the psi and becomes an A omega dagger, and I have this factor of e to the minus beta omega by 2. So now, but I know what this correlation function is, the A in the A dagger. It's similar to that guy, but doesn't have a factor of e to the minus beta omega. So this is equal to, and so this result is just the same thing, but with a minus beta omega by 2 here instead of a minus beta omega. And I don't know if you remember, but if you can go look back at your notes, this is precisely what we wanted the correlation function of the tildes and the ordinary operators to be. This is precisely the entanglement that you need in order for the horizon to be smooth. So you see that we've got the cross correlator, the cross correlation function correct as well. Okay? And for good measure, we can also compute this guy NA that I discussed, that I mentioned was the right combination of the creation and of the tildes and the ordinary operators to give you the number operators measured by the infalling observer. So I'll just remind you of what that expression is. The NA, this is the number operator that's obtained by a standard Bogoliubov transform, is just this. And then there's one more term. E. Okay, so this is a standard derivation of how you get this guy. You can look, if you look at Birrell and Davies, it'll tell you how to, you know, start with the ordinary operators on both sides of the horizon. If you just believe in effective field theory, you can derive the infalling, the number operator seen by the infalling observer. But what's of interest to us is that you look at this formula and you see that NA on psi is explicitly zero. Okay? And the reason for that is the following. You know, there are two parts to each expression. Okay, this is some positive operator, and there are two parts to each expression. Each expression has the form alpha dagger alpha. But you look at this term, this has an A tilde acting on psi. But remember, by this rule here, the A tilde acting on psi is just an e to the minus beta omega by 2 into an A dagger acting on psi. Okay? So this term, when it acts on psi, is going to cancel this term. And the same here. Okay, here you have an A tilde dagger acting on psi, but that's the same as an e to the plus beta omega by 2 into an ordinary A acting on psi. So that's going to cancel this term. These terms, by the way, don't annihilate psi. Okay? But the front of the bracket does annihilate psi. Okay? So you can see by explicit computation that NA, defined in the standard way, acting on psi is zero. Okay? So you see, what I wanted to show you is that these very simple definitions of the tilde operators defined in this way, which when I defined it didn't seem very well motivated, are designed so as to give you a smooth horizon, so as to give you all the properties that we required from the tilde, and then you can compute explicitly the number operator seen by the infalling observer, and you find that it's zero. Okay? So this construction of the tildes allows you to construct a local field in a such a way that the horizon is smooth. Okay? So that's the first important point I wanted to make. I'm happy to stop here and have questions, and then I want to go on and discuss how this happened in spite of the impossibility theorems that we tried to discuss with the AMPS impossibility theorems. But maybe before that, I can just see if there are any questions on the technical aspects of this. So these manipulations are very simple. If you just go back home and do them once, you'll be able to do them, I'm sure. Yeah.
Can you just remind us, these capital A's are defined by taking polynomials in coarse-grained observables?
That's right, of these O's.
Yeah, so in particular, they're not going to be Poincaré invariants.
They're not going to be Poincaré invariants. Sorry, because of the coarse training?
Yeah.
Okay, that's right. So there's some slight coarse training yes.
So, I mean, in particular, that means that 1 isn't in the algebra, surely.
Sorry, why isn't 1 in the algebra? I put in 1 in the algebra.
One
is certainly in the algebra.
You put it in by hand.
No, 1 is certainly in the algebra. I mean, if anything is in the algebra, 1 is in the algebra.
I don't see how it can, how 1 can possibly obey the algebraic relations you've asked for.
I don't understand. Why is that? This is a question of the definition of the O tilde omegas.
Yeah.
So I'm not asking for any relations of the A alphas. The A alphas are just some fixed set I give to you. A alphas are the set of all observations you can make. It's some set of operators. It doesn't even have to be an algebra, actually. It's just some set of operators.
Well, okay.
So you give me A alpha, and now I'm trying to define the O tilde omegas.
Sure, but if I in particular take these expressions where A alpha equals 1,
yes,
then any O is going to commute with 1.
Any so O? No, these are O tilde omega, guys. This is an O tilde.
Okay,
so this is the definition of how the O tilde acts on the base state psi. If you put 1 here and 1 here. It tells you that the action of O tilde on the state is this, is e to the minus beta omega into omega dagger.
Okay, so you're just saying that for this one very specific...
That's one of the equations. The one is certainly there, but you know, the set of the A omegas give you, A alphas give you a set of linear equations. So you give me a set of A alphas, I get a set of linear equations, and I solve them. So one is most certainly there. I mean, it's the most natural operator to include, and you get... when you put 1 there, it gives you one of the linear equations. There are other linear equations that enter with other operators.
So it's just on this specific state psi that say...
That's right.
O tilde basically acts...
Absolutely, it's
on
this specific state. That's
okay,
right.
Fine.
Okay, good. So now,
I have a question. Are these A's and A tildes, are they also part of the space that you defined last time,
capital A, I'm really sorry, I should have been more consistent with my notation. The A's and the O's are related by rescaling. So it's just a number. So they, you know, it's a complex vector space, it's just a number.
My question is, are they part of the space in which the A alpha lives?
Yes. So the A's, are the A tildes also part of the space in which it lives? Is that the question?
Yes.
Okay, so the A alpha is initially defined using the ordinary operators. When you define the A alpha, you can define this Hilbert space at psi that I mentioned, which is the action of the algebra on this space psi. The O tildes are also operators within that space. Okay? So they're operators which also act on at psi. Okay, but you don't use them to initially define the A's. You initially define the A's without using the O tildes, without using the tildes, because you need the A's first to define the tildes. But there is a Hilbert space at psi, and both the A's and the tildes all act in the same Hilbert space.
Yes, but I mean, my question is, because you now constructed a lot of operators that make psi vanish, the state psi vanish, right?
That make the state?
That's psi vanish.
That's right.
So this you excluded earlier,
yes.
But it looks like you have a high-dimensional subspace.
Very good.
Where this
so if you look at these relations and all the manipulations I did, every time I had an A tilde, and then I had an A in front of it. You see, I never tried to commute O tilde through another O tilde. So if you just go back and look at the manipulations I did, I always use this, and there was never an O tilde sitting here. So this relation in particular does not hold if you put in another O tilde.
So that was my question. O tilde is not part of the space.
I beg your pardon?
So that was my question. So O tilde is not part of
the space. O tilde is not part of the A's, as you start with, but it does act in the same space as the A size does. But it's a different thing. But it's not part of the A's to define it. Yes. Yes.
If I took Rindler horizon instead of a black hole horizon, what would change?
Okay, so let's talk about that this thing. Okay, can we just let's talk about it later in the discussion session. Okay, fine. Okay, good. So, okay, good. So let me go on. Let me try and emphasize. You know, how is it that you were able to get past these impossibility theorems. So the key point here is, as some of you have already pointed out, is the fact that these operators are all state-dependent, in the sense that we're defining the operators so as to be the correct operators that are used by an infalling observer when he falls into the black hole in a particular state. If the black hole happens to be in a very different state, then the infalling observer would use a different set of observables. And this is something that's natural because these are local operators in some theory of quantum gravity, and so it might well be that well before you say, you know, while you might think that phi of x is some well-defined thing, which is phi at a point x, even before you can make sense of that, you might need to give me a reference state so that I can determine the geometry and various other properties, and so it might well be, or it's very natural, that in quantum gravity you need to give me a state before I can make sense of what local operators mean. Okay? And that's the key property of these operators, and that's what in some sense was not accounted for in the AMPS arguments, which assumed that you have some metric operator or you have some field operator, and the field operator behind the horizon is a well-defined operator globally everywhere in the Hilbert space. So I'll just emphasize that by going through these various arguments once again, but this is the key point that enters in most of these loopholes. Okay? So in particular, for example, if you look at the counting argument. Okay, so remember the counting argument was that now how can this be true? This is equal to 1, but yet A tilde looks like it lowers the energy. But if you look at the way this A tilde is defined, the way it's defined. So by the way, let me give you the resolution, and then I want to add one more thing to that. If you look at the way this A tilde is defined, you have some energy E. Okay. The space psi lives in this energy E. It's some point in the set of states of energy E. And then you excite it. So you get some states of higher energy and some states of lower energy. So there's some states around the energy E. There's some other part of the CFT Hilbert space, which is at E minus omega. Okay. And what this A tilde and A tilde daggers are doing, I'm mapping you from some subspace here in the space of A minus omega. Okay. So this is what the A tilde dagger does. And this is what the A tilde does. So it's true that the A tilde daggers and the A tildes have unusual properties in that one maps you from a higher energy state to a lower energy state and the other does the opposite, but they don't care about, you know, whether globally the space here at E minus omega has less volume than the space here, because they're just acting within some limited part of the space. Now they're acting within the space at psi, which is constructed about this base state psi and in excitations about this base state psi. So the fact that there's some, you know, globally there's some problem in defining a map from here to here, which is invertible, is true. But this doesn't care about that, because globally, this A tilde dagger is not one. Now, you don't want this to be true globally. You just want this to be true. What you really want is that this should be true. this should be equal to psi psi. Or you might ambitiously, more ambitiously, demand that you can do some other experiments, and then maybe this should be true. You put some operators here, you put some operators here, and this should be true. Okay? And you should have the same operators come back here. So within correlation functions about the state psi, this should be true. Okay? But you don't want this to be true as some operator equation in the full Hilbert space. If you demand that it's true as an operator equation in the full Hilbert space, you run into trouble. That's not what you need. Okay, effective field theory doesn't require you to have this relation true as an operator equation in the whole Hilbert space. It requires you to have this relation appear to be true for an infalling observer. Okay, so this appears to be true for an infalling observer within all experiments that he can access, but it's not true for someone, you know, who can access a whole Hilbert space. He'll see that these operators don't behave correctly on the whole Hilbert space. Okay? Let me say one more thing, by the way, about this counting argument. The counting argument, this is a resolution to the counting argument, but suffers from slightly one more problem, which is that it can also be resolved by these edge effects. For example, as you know, if you look at the coarse graining I wrote down, you will see that if you actually try and define these frequencies, not as infinitely sharp frequencies defined over infinite time, but as the Fourier transforms of the field measured over some finite time, then you will always have some positive energy contamination. So really, the A tilde dagger does this, but it also maps the state a little bit, you know, to something of higher energy. Okay? So there's a small part which does this. So really, there are these edge effects. If you try and coarse grain your operators appropriately, you can get rid of the strict counting argument even anyway, even without appealing to the state dependence. So in any case, the counting argument is not such a robust argument because it relies on the fact that you want these guys to have strictly small energy. The moment you give them slightly positive energy, or the moment you define them by means of time bands on the boundary, which are not infinitely extended, then you can see that, in fact, this lack of a left inverse argument, the rigorous lack of a left inverse argument, breaks down. But there's a better version of that argument, which is not sensitive to these, you know, to having an infinite time range in the boundary. And the better version of the argument is the argument I described, which was this occupancy argument, which was robust to these 1 by n corrections and these corrections to coarse graining. And that was the argument that if you compute a trace of A tilde omega dagger, it looked like you were getting something nonsensical. You were getting a negative number, whereas this is clearly a positive number. However, you see clearly what the problem here is. The problem here is when you compute this trace, you assume that it's the same operator that you're measuring, you know, in all the states, in all the microstates of the black hole. Okay? However, as you know, we computed the expectation value of this guy in the black hole microstate, and you see that it is the right expectation value. But if you try and take this operator as is defined about a black hole microstate and try and insert it in a trace about the full Hilbert space, then you get something that's wrong because you shouldn't be using the same operator. In particular, an observer who falls into a black hole in a different state will use a different A tilde omega. Okay? So there, this operator depends also on the state in which the black hole is. Just 1 second. So if you neglect the fact that these operators, you know, have to change as you go to a different microstate because they're local operators and you need the state as a reference to define them, then you run into contradictions. And so there's no contradiction. And really, you take the state, it's designed to give you the right expectation value, but you shouldn't try and evaluate a trace with it. Yeah?
How do different observers compare notes?
I beg your pardon?
How do different observers compare
different notes? Different observers in totally different states of the black hole, they don't compare notes. So you can think of a density matrix where you can try and think of a black hole in a superposition of being, you know, state 1 and state 2. But what will happen in that case is that an infalling observer will measure some results with probability half and some other results with probability half. There's no way, you know, from the point of view of effective field theory, these different microstates effectively live in different superselection sectors. Because if you look at cross-correlation functions of these A alphas between two different microstates that are far away in the Hilbert space, they're exponentially suppressed. So there's no meaning to these cross-correlations within effective field theory. Observers they don't compare notes in that sense. There's a density matrix you can speak of. You can speak of saying that you're in this microstate with probability half and that microstate with probability half. But there's no sense in which the cross terms are important, and that's why this works.
So there will be no global description whatsoever?
There's no global description within effective field theory. There is a global description in the CFT. On the CFT, all of these states exist. But there's no sense in which this cross-correlation function has any physical meaning. No, if I take a black hole and I change and I ask for, you know, A alpha, and I have some other black hole on the other side, BH1, BH2, this doesn't have any natural meaning within effective field theory. Okay, so there's a meaning to an observer falling in. There's a meaning to a density matrix where you take black hole 1 and black hole 1 and black hole 2 and black hole 2. The density matrix has meaning, but there's no meaning to these cross correlators within effective field theory. And that's because effectively these guys are in different superselection sectors. And that's why it works. I mean, they're not exactly in superselection sectors, but these correlation functions are e to the minus n squared suppressed. Okay. Very good. So this is one. The resolution to the NA argument, by the way. Remember I said that this was... So this argument is a better version of the counting argument because it's robust against these edge effects. There was this other argument, remember, which was the NA argument, which is precisely the same problem. You know, if you use the same... So we computed once again, as I showed you some time back, that NA on psi was 0, but if you try and use the same operator, if you try and declare that there's the infalling observer in all states measures the same operator every time, then that doesn't make sense, and you'll get absurd results by looking at the trace of the number operator. And it's the same problem. You can't take the trace in a naive way over these state-dependent operators. There's a sensible way in which you can speak of the average NA as his measures of all microstates. That's something which is sensible. You can say, you know, what is the average that an infalling observer would measure if I took some density matrix? But if you do that, you have to make sure that the number operator that you construct is the right number operator for each state that you're looking at. If you try and take the trace while keeping the number operator fixed or demand that it should be some fixed operator, then that just doesn't work. Okay. So that's the central issue with these arguments. Let me mention also the other argument that I spoke about in the morning, which is the strong subadditivity argument, because it has a slightly more interesting answer. It's not just an issue of state dependence. So remember, now I mentioned to you in the morning a strong subadditivity argument, which was based on looking at an old black hole and looking at three regions, the part just inside, the part just outside, and the part far away. And it looked like it violated the strong subadditivity of entropy. So there was this guy B, which was falling outside, C, which was falling inside. There was this cloud of old Hawking radiation, which was A. And there's a strong subadditivity of entropy argument, which is SAB plus SBC, okay, greater than or equal to SA plus SC. And that's violated because SAB is smaller than SA and SBC is 0, whereas SC is order 1. Okay? So it looks like you're getting a violation with this. But how does this construction resolve this argument? The way it resolves this argument is slightly interesting and is not just an issue of state dependence, but it gives you it's an issue of what used to be called black hole complementarity, although in some sense this is a more precise version of black hole complementarity than has been previously constructed, and that's the following. You could think of these C's as being described by the 8 fiddles. Okay? These are the degrees of freedom that are described by the 8 fiddles. Okay? And the B's and the A's, you know, the A's, if you like, are the degrees of freedom that are described by the A's. Okay? So this is the subadditivity argument is not very precise in terms of local operators, but morally you can think of the degrees of freedom inside, the excitations inside as being the A tildes, and the excitations outside as being the A's. Then a tacit assumption into deriving the strong subadditivity is that A and C are independent. Okay? That A and C are strictly independent as Hilbert spaces. Okay, they're strictly independent parts of the Hilbert space. The Hilbert space factorizes into HA, into HB, into HC. Okay? But that would have been the statement that A tilde A is 0 as an operator. Okay? But A tilde A is not equal to 0 as an operator. So A tilde A is something which is non-zero. In fact, in some toy models, you can take the spin chain, you can construct these guys. A tilde A is non-zero, and it's non-zero precisely because of these edge effects. You see, if you take a very high point correlation function, if you take psi, you insert n omegas on it, omega 1, omega n, okay? And now you try and compute O tilde O on this guy, then these rules are not applicable. O tilde O was not designed to vanish on a state which was produced by the initial state and by exciting it by a huge number of insertions. Okay? So this expectation value may not be zero. And in fact, it is not zero. So you can take these states and you can actually do this construction. I don't have time, but I can show, or you can see online also. I can put this up. You can take a spin chain and you can construct these tildes explicitly, and you can check the commutator is not zero as an operator. The commutator is designed so that it appears to be zero for an infalling observer, but it's not zero as an operator. And in particular, by measuring an endpoint correlator, by measuring such a high point correlator that you go beyond the limits of this algebra that we designed, you can measure this non-zero correlator. Therefore, the Hilbert space that's described by C and A is not independent. And so A and C are not really independent degrees of freedom, but this interdependence between, so C in some sense, if you like to think of it physically, is a scrambled version of the A's, but this interdependence is cleverly disguised, so it's completely invisible to an infalling observer unless he measures an endpoint correlator. So there is an interdependence. The inside of the black hole is in some sense a scrambled version of the outside, but it's something that's invisible. So this used to be called black hole complementarity, but here you see that it's really true in equations. You have these equations that describe these O tildes. The O tildes are designed so they commute with the O's within ordinary experiments, but don't actually commute as operators, and therefore the strong subadditivity paradox doesn't apply. Okay, so that's the resolution to the strong subadditivity paradox. Okay, so that's the reason these tildes work. I have about 15 or 20 minutes left, but I'm happy to take questions here, and then I want to go on and speak about some more recent work that we have. Yes. But the point is that A and C are not independent degrees of freedom. So strong subadditivity is a precise statement of the monogamy of entanglement. At least it's one of the precise statements of the monogamy of entanglement. However, if C is actually part of A, if you want to think of it physically, you can think in terms of wormholes, so we don't have to. They're actually, these degrees of freedom are actually the same as these degrees of freedom, then there's no such identity you can write down. So the writing down this identity requires that the Hilbert space has this form. And there are some operators. These operators, are separate. But if they're not separate, and here they're not separate because A tilde and O don't commute as operators, then there's no strong subadditivity. So the monogamy of entanglement is okay. It should be, it's visible as an effective description. But if you start demanding these things extremely accurately, and you start demanding that really the Hilbert space here should be free of the Hilbert space here, that's like demanding absolute locality. But that just doesn't work, or doesn't seem to work in quantum gravity. Okay. Yes?
Doesn't this mean that Hawking radiation somehow depends on what's a black hole radiated?
Yes, it depends. It depends on what's behind, but it depends in a very subtle way. With an effective field theory, you don't see this dependence. So it's you try and measure the correlators of some Hawking radiation far away, and they're precisely what's predicted by effective field theory. But if you try to measure an endpoint correlation function, then you see this dependence. So there is this dependence, but it's hidden. I'll say a little more about this dependence if I get to it at the end. So this dependence is actually an exponentially small dependence. The size of this correlator, if you estimate it, is actually e to the minus n. So there is an exponentially small dependence on what's left behind. It's a non-local effect. It's a long-distance non-local effect, but that's just how it is, and there's no reason you would want to rule that out. Yeah.
So this morning you said that there was still a set of measure zero where you can't define these?
Yes. So there's a set of measure zero where you can't define this, and we're actually happy to call those the firewall states. These linear equations don't have a solution. There are no O tilde operators. So you just can't define, these linear equations don't have a solution. So we are happy to call those the firewall states. Some of those are what you'd expect to be firewall states, just by looking at intuition from Rindler. Okay, good. Let me say a few things about work my recent stuff, But I just want to mention a few. So if you look at the literature, there's a fair amount of debate about this proposal. Let me mention a few objections and their resolutions. Okay. One objection is the so-called frozen vacuum objection of Busso. Okay. It's the following objection. It's the following objection. It's a statement that, your construction should not have. So I cheated a little bit when I gave you this construction. I'm now going to introduce a slight subtlety in this construction. Now, this should not be true for all states. It should not be true for all states you know, even within effective field theory, because just before the infalling observer falls in, I could shoot a beam that could excite the horizon. So then I would expect the infalling observer to be able to see particles. Okay? So if you have a construction that says NA psi is equal to zero for all states, that's a problem. That freezes the vacuum. You know, it makes all infalling observers see the vacuum, which is not good. Okay? So this is called the frozen vacuum objection of Rafael Busso. And it's basically this statement, at least what I understand of it is this statement, that NA psi should not be zero for all states. Okay. Now, and that's right, and indeed NA psi should not be zero. So in fact, we have to be slightly more careful in doing our construction. So we were slightly more careful, but I hid it in these lectures. Let me just say, when you define these operators in this way, you need to be careful that your operators are equilibrium states. Okay, so strictly speaking, the definition that I wrote down, the equations that I wrote down, are equations that hold about equilibrium states. So what are equilibrium states? One necessary, almost sufficient, but not quite sufficient condition for a state to be an equilibrium state is if I look at this guy, okay, then it's some constant value plus some term that goes like e to the minus s by 2 into a time variation. Okay? So equilibrium states have the property that if their correlation functions in equilibrium states are time translationally independent. Okay? So you measure something now, and you can measure two-point correlation functions, but they only depend on the differences of the times. Okay? You could do an experiment now, or you could do an experiment sometime later, and you'll get the same answer in an equilibrium state because nothing is happening. Okay, so intuitively, that's the definition. And you can check that most states, in fact, are of this form. They are in equilibrium. To check that most states are in this form, what you need to do is use what's called the eigenstate thermalization hypothesis. I think I have time to explain it very quickly, not in very great detail, which is the following statement. And it's a statement that's presumably obeyed by operators in n equal to 4 super Young Mills. There's no proof, of course. But the eigenstate thermalization hypothesis, which you need to use to prove that most states are equilibrium states, is the following hypothesis. It's a statement that if you look at any element of this algebra, you look at two energy eigenstates. Okay? So Ei and Ej are two energy eigenstates. Then you find that this has some number. There are some diagonal terms. Okay? And then there are some off-diagonal terms. And the off-diagonal terms have the form that they look like e to the minus s by 2, where s is the density of states at the energy E. Okay, so I'm assuming that Ei and Ej are not too separate. If they are, we can refine this a little. E to the minus s by 2 into some term which is Rij. Okay? And Rij is some term, it's some matrix which has erratic phases. It's a matrix which has entries which are order 1 and has erratic phases. And the overall scaling here is an e to the minus s by 2. Okay? So this is called the eigenstate thermalization hypothesis. It's actually, even though the first time you see it, it looks somewhat unusual. You know, why should this be the form of matrix elements in energy eigenstates? It's actually true, and it's simply the following statement. So this was first proposed by Srednicki and others. You can go look at those papers. They're quite nice. But it's roughly, really intuitively, the following statement. It's the statement that the eigenvectors of the operator A are not really correlated with the energy eigenstates. So to go from the energy eigenstates to whatever the eigenvectors of the operator A are involves some unitary transformation, which is some unitary transformation that you try to pick generically. So if you start with an operator A that's obviously diagonal in its own eigenvector basis, and then do a random unitary transform, do some generic kind of unitary transform, then you find that you get this form. So really, it's the statement that the energy eigenstates are not special states in the Hilbert space. It's only that statement. And that's a statement that you expect might be true in an interacting quantum field theory. And it probably is, and it is true in many statistical mechanics systems. It just is true that the energy eigenstates aren't special states in the theory. I mean, they're special with respect to the Hamiltonian, but they're not special for some other operators. Okay? Okay. If you use this and you try and estimate in a generic state, you know, what the size of these guys is, so you write down some generic state, which looks like Ci into Ei. Okay. You pull the energies from some range, and of course the Ci's have to be normalized. Okay. And then you try and estimate this object. You see that you'll get, if you try and now estimate the expectation value of Psi, you'll see that the, you'll get some term from the diagonal expectation values, but the time variance, okay, comes only from the off-diagonal terms of A, right? Because the terms that are diagonal, that have EI here and EI here in this expansion, are not going to have any time variance. So it's only the off-diagonal terms which will give you time variance, okay? But the off-diagonal terms, if you estimate them here, are of the following form. They are CI CJ star, okay, into e to the minus s by 2 into Rij. Okay. So if you like, I can write down a full formula plus squared AFTI. Okay, so this is now a full formula. I'm sorry again for those of you at the back, but this is in the notes so you can look it up if you can't read it. Okay, so the expectation value of psi in the state is ci squared into aei plus this, and if you time translate it, if you do this time evolution, these terms don't care about this time evolution because they're sandwiched between e on the left and e on the right, so the e to the iht cancels between them. These terms do, but now you have to estimate the size of these terms. The thing is that generically you expect the ci's to be of order e to the minus s by 2 because sum of ci squared is 1 over e to the s states. So that means that this term here is e to the minus s. This term here is e to the minus s by 2. Okay? So you have a sum roughly of e to the minus 3s by 2 into rij over e to the 2s states. Because there are e to the 2s states, you're summing over both I and over j. But because these phases are erratic, this sum over e to the 2s has a typical magnitude which is just e to the s. So the estimate is that this is e to the minus s by 2. And that's because you're summing over e to the 2s states over terms which have a typical magnitude of e to the minus 3s by 2 and aren't correlated by the eigenstate thermalization hypothesis. And so you get something that looks like e to the minus s by 2. And that's the statement that typical states are equilibrium states and they obey some property of this kind. Okay? However, not all states are equilibrium states. Okay? In particular, if I start with a state which looks like which is an equilibrium state, and then I excite it with an element of the algebra itself, then that's not an equilibrium state. Okay? So in particular, if I start with an equilibrium state, then I excite it with a Hermitian element of the algebra. This is a unitary matrix if this is Hermitian. This is not an equilibrium state. So psi prime, okay? If psi is equilibrium, then psi prime is not equilibrium. So if you're in a non-equilibrium state, if someone just comes and gives you the state psi prime, then you don't want that Na is equal to 0 in that state. This you expect is an excited state. Someone has done something. And you can guess that someone has done something by measuring correlation functions in psi prime. And you see that these correlation functions are not time translationally invariant. So let me give you a concrete example. For example, let's say you start with these e omegas, and you act with e to the I lambda o omega plus o omega dagger, okay, on psi. So you start with an equilibrium state, and you act with a Hermitian operator of this kind. You call this psi prime. Okay. Then you should measure, you can do this, it's a simple exercise. I won't do it right now, but it's a simple exercise. Look at correlators of this guy, O omega minus O omega dagger in psi prime. These correlators are clearly going to evolve with time, okay, because this has an e to the I omega t evolution, this has an e to the minus I omega t evolution. And these correlators are not exponentially small in this state psi. In the state psi prime. Okay, you can just do the computation. If you assume that they are exponentially small in the state psi, you excite the state psi in this way, you'll find that these correlators get a non-zero expectation, which is proportional to lambda. So therefore, by using this, you can prove that given an excited state of this kind, it has a unique decomposition into an element of the algebra times an equilibrium state. Okay? So if someone just comes and gives me an excited state of this kind, I can guess not only what the base equilibrium state was, but also how it was excited by means of the algebra. Okay? So if I'm in a state of this kind, which is, let me call this u psi just for notation, so u is e to the I alpha, then there's a slightly different definition of the O's that I should use, and that definition is as follows. So if someone gives me a state psi prime, which is of this kind, I just argued, I didn't prove, but it's it's true that you can uniquely guess U and Psi, then the definition is that O omega tilde on A alpha Psi prime is actually A alpha into U omega dagger U dagger omega by 2 into Psi. What is this definition doing? What is definition into psi prime, sorry. What this definition is doing is guessing that psi prime is of this form, u psi, and then it's stripping off the u by means of this u dagger, making the u o dagger commute through it, and putting back the u here. Okay? So this definition is designed so that on non-equilibrium states, the action of the o tildes is like that on the base equilibrium state. And therefore, you can check, so if you look at our paper, we check that by means of this definition, you make sure that even a non-equilibrium state, O tilde satisfies the expectation that you have. So in this kind of state, for example, if you try and measure Na psi prime, and you use this definition, you find it's not zero, as indeed it shouldn't be zero. Now, if you try and take Na and try and take a non-equilibrium state, you'll find it's non-zero, and that's precisely what is predicted, in fact, by effective field theory, and you can check that other such predictions work out as well. Yeah.
Can you see that for late times that this would?
Yes, you can see also for late times that it will decay. Yes. You can see also that if you wait for long enough, then it settles back into an equilibrium state. That's one more thing we checked. I mean, that's a property of the Green's functions in AdS, but you can check that. Good. Let me say one more thing. So, this is so Harlow and Van Ramstrong, said, oh, okay, so you can do this, but let's do something more clever, and that's the following. Now let's take the psi, you take a psi, you construct something, let me construct my tildes, and now let me take a different state, okay? Which is not e to the I a alpha on psi, but which is e to the I a twiddle alpha on psi, okay? So it's a u twiddle. So this is like a beam which is just sitting behind the horizon waiting to hit you. So there's a horizon here, and there's some malicious person who sent off a beam here, and the beam is just waiting to hit the infalling observer. So this is the infaller. And there's a beam here. But the beam is hiding behind the horizon. Okay? So how do you know? So you think the horizon is smooth and you jump in, but then the beam comes and hits you. Okay? And so what Harlow and Van Ramstrong asked is, more precisely Van Ramstrong, but Harlow also wrote something similar, how do you know if I give you a state of this kind, it looks like it's an equilibrium state, because in fact you try and measure correlators of ordinary operators, they're completely unchanged because the ordinary operators are designed to commute with the u twiddles. However, that's not quite true, and the reason it's not quite true is because even in these guys, the things that develop time invariance, time dependence, are things which involve the Hamiltonian. Okay? So if you insert energy behind the horizon, it's true, it's very hard to see, but you do know that someone has inserted energy inside because there's an EDM Hamiltonian at infinity that jumps. So there's something at infinity which you can measure, which is the Hamiltonian. So in particular, if you look at states of this kind, and you look at correlators with the Hamiltonian inserted, not just correlators of A alpha, okay? These guys develop time dependence. Okay? So these guys get non-zero values where they would initially have had zero values. So you have to use correlation functions of these guys with the Hamiltonian inserted, and they differ from their values in equilibrium states. Okay? So you can use observables of this kind to detect not only the unitaries in front of the horizon, but also unitaries behind the horizon, and then strip them off and modify your construction appropriately in the same way. I just have to write u twiddles there. Okay? So you can detect unitaries in front and unitaries behind the horizon as well. Okay, let me just say one last thing that's related to a question that was asked also. There's one more issue which Mathur has raised, and I'll just spend a few minutes talking about it. The question is as follows. I said some time back that there's non-locality, and there's non-locality over large distances. It lives within endpoint correlators, but there's non-locality over large distances. Now, you might say, I don't believe that. Why should I believe your construction that there's non-locality over large distances? You have some other evidence for that. You came and you said there's non-locality, but I think you shouldn't have non-locality over large distances. Is there some other evidence? And it turns out there is. And the first thing to ask there is, why do you even expect locality to exist in quantum gravity? So if you think of the path integral of quantum gravity, the path integral is summing over all kinds of metrics, And why do you expect locality to exist? Locality is, after all, defined with respect to one particular metric. And the answer is that this path integral has saddle points. It has saddle points where you can do an asymptotic series expansion about a particular metric, and this has, and in AdS CFT, this has a 1 by n expansion. So the fact that you have a 1 by n expansion is what tells you that locality exists. So if you want to look for situations where the 1 by n expansion breaks down and you have to go back to the full non-perturbative path integral, then that's a good place where you expect locality to break down. Okay? So one sign of the breakdown of locality in AdS CFT, it's a sign, it's not a proof, is the breakdown of the 1 by n expansion. Okay? And what I want to show you very quickly in the last 2 minutes is how, if you look at endpoint correlators, it's quite easy, or endpoint scattering amplitudes in AdS, it's quite easy to argue just from general arguments that the 1 by n expansion breaks down, which is a strong sign that locality breaks down. And so that's independent evidence of what I just said, which is that if you look at very high point correlation functions, then you don't expect locality to hold. Okay? So it's actually a very simple argument, and goes as follows. Imagine a p-point scattering amplitude in AdS. You have p points, so that they're p external points. Let's estimate the size of this amplitude. The estimate of the size of this amplitude is the number of Feynman diagrams, which is p factorial. There's a subleading term here, which I won't bother about, and the coupling constant, which is actually 1 by n, okay, to the power p minus 2. You can estimate that the coupling constant appears this way. So this is the size of the tree level amplitude. So m tree. Now you look at the one, so I'm looking at a scattering amplitude which has p external points in anti-de Sitter space. Now let's look at the one loop amplitude. Okay. So the one loop amplitude is the following. The way you do it is you look at n points, p minus m points on one side, and m points on the other side, okay, and you estimate how much this is. So if you cut this one loop amplitude, you can in fact estimate the size of this one loop amplitude as the product of three level amplitudes. And it's easy to see that this is nothing but PCM, which is the number of such divisions that you have, okay, sum over all m, okay, into the size of this amplitude, into the size of this amplitude. So it's m factorial into p minus m factorial, okay, into a factor of 1 by n to the p. Not 1 by n to the p minus 2, but a factor of 1 by n to the p. Okay? But if you just expand this out, you'll see that this is, so this is larger, it's roughly equal to p squared, so you expand this out, you get a p factorial and a p minus m factorial from here. It's m plus 2, if this was m factorial, then this cut here has m plus 2 points, and this cut here has p minus m plus 2 points. Apologies for that. So if you just estimate this, you'll see you'll get an m factorial and an m minus p factorial from the denominator. But this whole term, okay, the m1 loop, my m tree, okay, has some expansion that has a 1 by n squared from the coupling constant, but it has some terms that scale positively with p. I don't want to take very seriously the fact that I think you'll get a p cubed if you expand this out. And that's because whether you get a cubed or not depends on the subleading term here. If you had a p minus 3 factorial, you would just get a p squared. Okay, so it's you have to be careful in estimating the subleading term to estimate the size of this coefficient t. But you can check that the moment you take p to be of n, okay, p to be of the size n, the one loop amplitude becomes as large as the tree level amplitude. So this is just Feynman diagram counting. Just Feynman diagram counting tells you that if you look at an endpoint amplitude with a coupling constant of 1 by n, then perturbation series in 1 by n breaks down. Okay? So that's an independent, and this is a well-known fact in quantum field theory. If you try to do quantum electrodynamics with 137 external particles, you can't do that perturbatively. Okay? So you do quantum field theory with a coupling constant of g squared, you take 1 by g squared external particles, perturbation theory breaks down. In this case, the coupling constant is 1 by n. You take n particles, the large n series breaks down, and so that's a strong sign that locality breaks down completely independently of our construction. Okay, so I'll just stop here. Let me just try and take a step back and summarize everything that I said. And I said that there are these modern versions of the information paradox. I just take 2 minutes more, that's fine. So there are these modern versions of the information paradox, which are all phrased, you know, which are rather precise versions. You know, they're something you can write down and say, here's a paradox. But they're all phrased in the following way. You take some rules from effective field theory, okay, and then you argue that for some broad global reasons, the operators that you want that obey the right rules of effective field theory can't exist in the CFT. But as I tried to point out, there's a hidden assumption, and the hidden assumption is that somehow local operators in quantum gravity are state independent. But if you drop that assumption, if you're willing to accept the fact that the operator that a local operator that an observer measures, even before you can define what a local operator is, you have to give me a sense of what the state is, and it's only then that I can talk about the operator here. And what you call the field here, even though it's conceptually the same thing, may be a different operator in one state and a different operator in some other state. There's no way to compare those two. Then you can find loopholes in all these arguments and explicitly construct these local operators that satisfy all the properties that you need. And then you have to be a little more careful. You have to be careful that there are no ambiguities in your construction. So I tried to hint very quickly at the end how you can resolve a lot of these ambiguities. And this is where, if you look at the literature, there's a fair amount of discussion about whether there are ambiguities or not. I think we've managed to resolve most of these ambiguities, as I described. And then there are other issues, other predictions that this makes. It gives you a version of black hole complementarity, which says that locality breaks down in a very specific way in endpoint correlation functions. But that's not just a prediction in the air. It's something that's borne out by completely independent Feynman diagram analyses, and just completely independent analyses of when large N breaks down, which is a sign that locality breaks down. So I think there are many more interesting questions to ask and answer here, in particular this issue of state dependence and whether in general you should be allowed state dependence. It doesn't lead to any, you know, contradiction with quantum mechanics, as people say, because these observers are designed, these operators are designed to satisfy the rules of quantum effective field theory. But nevertheless, it's a very interesting question. It's something that seems to be rather special to gravity. And there are, you know, many other issues to explore here, as you can see. So I think I'll stop there and we can take more questions.
Suppose you have a gravity dual for your system. How would you compute correlation functions for your operator A?
Sorry, I didn't understand. Suppose you have, in all this case, I always had a gravity dual, yes.
Exactly.
Yes.
So by using AdS CFT, how would you compute correlation functions for your operator A?
For the operators
of A.
A, just ordinary A?
Exactly.
Those are just computed by Witten diagrams. That's the ordinary computation of Witten diagrams. So you have, you know, the correlation functions for operators A are not hard to compute. Those are dual to Witten diagrams. So that's just.
So you don't have a source.
I beg your pardon?
I mean, you don't have a dual operator on the book or something like that associated to it?
No, so the A's are products of these O operators. These O's are what are dual to these fields phi in the bulk. So if you like, you can think of correlation functions of A as limits of correlation functions of phi taken in the bulk with the points taken towards the boundary. So you can compute them that way. But the correlation functions of the A are some standard well-understood thing. That's not. Here we're only interested in what happens if you try and fall through the horizon. So the A's you can just compute. So one way you can compute them if you take this construction is you take these constructions and you take the limit of these correlation functions of phi as you go towards the boundary. You'll have to strip off a leading z to the delta term and you'll get back correlators of the A's in the CFT. You take correlators of phi and take z goes to 0 in the formulas I wrote.
Can you elaborate a bit on why the breakdown of perturbation theory for large p is related to the breakdown of locality?
Oh, good. Thank you. So why is it related to breakdown of locality? The first question is, you know, why do you expect locality to hold? Okay. I think that's the first question one has to ask in quantum gravity. Why is quantum gravity local? It's only local because at times you can do a saddle point approximation of a correlation function. So you have a correlation function, you do a saddle point approximation. What that's telling you is that the metric, the sum over all metrics, is freezing to a particular semi-classical metric, and then you do an asymptotic series expansion of some correlation function about that metric, and then you can define locality about that metric. So the only sense, I think, in which you should be able to define locality in quantum gravity, at least the only natural sense, there are other ways people try, is by means of a saddle point approximation. So you say that within some perturbation expansion, you have a certain metric, and then you define locality with respect to that metric. So you always have to have a saddle point in mind when you're speaking of locality. So the series expansion that you talk about in AdS CFT is the 1 by n expansion. So you do a 1 by n expansion of correlators about a certain saddle point. If the 1 by n expansion breaks down and you have to go back to the full path integral, you have to take into account non-perturbative effects, then there's no reason that non-perturbative effects should be local. It may happen that the 1 by n expansion resums into a different 1 by n expansion. Okay? But if the 1 by n expansion doesn't resum into a different 1 by n expansion, and you're really looking at non-perturbative effects, things that go like e to the minus n squared, then you have to take into account the full path integral over all metrics, and you don't expect, there's no sense in which you can even define locality for the full theory. You can only define locality within an asymptotic series expansion about a given saddle point. And so a breakdown of 1 by n is a very good sign for a breakdown of locality.
So you're saying
it may resum, as I said, but barring that.
So you're saying it's not possible to have classical evolution that is non-local?
I'm not saying that. The statement is that one of the questions that's been asked is, I said here that you look at a correlation function of an operator inside the horizon and operator outside the horizon, some correlation function of this kind. Okay, you dress this correlator with many, many guys. And this correlator, even if P1 and P2 are separated, does not vanish. So even in P1 and P2 are space-like separated, doesn't vanish. That's a violation of what you'd naively call microcausality in quantum field theory. But it's something that looks like it's necessary in our construction. So the question is this something that's very bad, or is there some other reason you should expect this to happen? And the statement is that if you really put n insertions inside the correlation function, then you should expect this to happen on independent grounds. You shouldn't expect microcausality to hold.
Why is a saddle point related to locality? I'm not quite sure I understand that.
Oh, that's what I said. Maybe you should talk later.
Okay.
Again.
Okay.
Okay. So the discussion will go on 20 minutes from now. So let's thank Suvrat again.